morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for the Sports Authority Board meeting. It's always good to be in Bridgestone Arena. We want to thank the Predators organization for hosting us. This organization continues to make our city proud, both on and off the ice, and please join me in congratulating them on another very successful season. And as always, please note that the appeals process for any action of this board can be found at the top of today's agenda. You have the meeting minutes from our April 19th meeting before you. Are there any questions regarding the minutes? There's a motion to approve. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and properly seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
The minutes are approved. At this time, we will hear from Monica Faulkneson for our Executive Director's Report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. Thank you for, we had great attendance at the Finance Committee meeting, and I appreciate that as well. You have the agenda before you. You will see that under item number 4, we are asking the board to consider a resolution approving an intent to award for the MLS Stadium, the design and architect piece. And we'll talk more about that in just a few minutes. But besides the intent to award, the authority will receive reports from both the Finance Committee and the Personnel Committee. We'll also have our time for facility questions and comments, and then we will receive the Bridgestone Arena report. Are there any questions about the agenda? Okay, then I have just a couple of updates for you from last month. And I did mention this at the Finance Committee meeting as well. You will recall that last month at the April meeting, the Sports Authority approved a resolution that ratified approval of those previously incurred expenses related to the stadium pre-development work. Metro Finance and Metro Accounting have been working to update and change this approval process. You'll remember that we initially were not included on that, and that was one of the requests that came out of that whole experience. So they are in the process of changing the approval route. I'll have a meeting next week with finance, with the accounting division, and I think that we'll be able to finalize that at that time. Secondly, that same resolution authorized the executive director in consultation with the chair to coordinate with the mayor, the finance director, and the purchasing agent to select the most appropriate Metro contractor to provide these capital project management services that we've been talking about. And so since last month's meeting, I've had multiple conversations with finance, the mayor's office, with our chair, and we've determined that we're going to use architectural firm Gobble Hayes Partners and also Capital Project Solutions. Both of them have existing contracts with Metro to serve as our program and project managers. Ron Gobble is here with us this morning. I mean, clearly he's no stranger to the authority. They serve as the program manager for construction of First Tennessee Park, and they've also partnered with General Services on a number of other projects around Metro and especially related to strategic planning. I think working with the police headquarters and the Family Justice Center, those master plans. So Ron, we're going to talk about the RFQ, and so Ron has served as our technical advisor as we've worked through that process, and you're going to hear from him in just a minute. Also with us this morning, Capital Project Solutions. CPS is a project manager or project management owner's rep firm, and so they manage all phases of construction project activities. They also worked on First Tennessee Park. They've also done some work on the Metro Office Building, which is next to Howard School on the campus that our office is on. They've worked with Lentz Public Health Center, and they're currently working on the Sheriff's Office complex downtown that's presently under construction. So we're going to be well represented. I think that's the short of it. So in the coming weeks, we will finalize the scope of work for both firms while we continue to move ahead on the preliminary planning of the stadium. So Ron, if you want to come up now, you can say a little bit more about yourself, and he's also working with the fairgrounds, and so he'll give you a brief update there too.
Yes, as Ms. Foxerson said, we are excited to be back on the project with the Sports Authority. I think this is going to be quite an adventure. It's going to be a good project for the city, and we're happy to be here. We've gone through the architectural and engineering process, selection process, and they're hopefully getting to negotiations and defining the scope as we move forward with that process. We're also working on fairgrounds and public engagement. We're starting today, in fact, at 11:30. We've got it open to the public to come in and give us input about how the fairgrounds improvement plan can best serve their various constituencies. We've got another session tonight at 6 that's open to the public. All of you are invited. We'd love to have you there. And then over the next couple of days, this is being led by the Civic Design Center. And then over the next couple of days, there will be opportunities for the public to meet with the various design team members, plus the design team members themselves will be digesting all that we collect in today's meetings, and then we will be pulling all that together next week. The final meeting, which will be mainly focused on the flea market, will be Friday the 25th, and then we have to have a report back from the Civic Design Center on the 29th for a public presentation. So all of you are invited to attend, and it's going to be, we're delighted to have the opportunity to hear back from the various constituencies about what's important to them to figure out. With that said, all the other things are in process. We're CPS and our firm are just getting started into this project, so we're trying to identify what's been done, keep the redundancy down, and keep it moving.
No, I think that's great. I'll be at the fairgrounds tonight, and more than anything, I mean, we'd love for you to come if you can, but we think it's really important that the Sports Authority understands the bigger picture and what's going on at the fairgrounds, and so we will keep you informed as we move through this. There's a lot of interest, clearly, and the public engagement part is very important. So thank you for that update.
Got any questions?
We'll be seeing you all the time. The last thing I wanted to mention in my report, and this just came in, but Bill Emmendorfer, the head of the Tennessee Sports Hall of Fame, is here, and he has just invited the board to the 2018 Champion Within luncheon. So I just wanted to make sure that you received this brochure. That's Saturday, June the 16th, at the Omni.
Michael, one of the banquets that night. So the invitations were the same.
Yes.
Thing. And at the banquet, a professional athlete of the year, Mike Fisher, and Tennessee of the year is the national president.
You just stole the whole presentation.
I've always been wanting to do that. But anyway, Tennessee of the year is the highest collective honor we ever give. We give it to Olympians, we give it to national championship teams, we give it to Pat Summit, but we give it to Predators. It's always a year in the rears. And unfortunately, this year, you know, we had a great season. I mean, best season we've ever had in the regular season, and we fell short of the playoffs. But we're celebrating last year because last year truly put Nashville on the map. And what the Predators did to put the city in the spotlight nationally and internationally was phenomenal. So the Predators are the Tennessee of the year.
Yeah. Well, congratulations, and thank you for the invitation.
Madam Chair, last year I had the good fortune of being inducted into the Hall of Fame, and it is a great weekend, and all of you that can participate, I think you would really, really enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there any questions? If not, that concludes my report.
Thank you, Monica. Next on the agenda, we have consideration of a resolution approving an intent to award letter for the MLS Stadium Architect Design.
Okay, well, so let me tell you about the process. I know we've been talking about this. With regards to the RFQ and this evaluation, the whole piece, the Sports Authority is the lead department. Metro Purchasing convenes an evaluation committee. We review the proposals and then have the opportunity to interview offers that are deemed acceptable, which we did. Metro Purchasing then compiles the scoring and all the documents, sends it to the mayor, who selects the award. He also receives the committee's recommendation. The mayor received the information from Metro Purchasing. He's made a selection. He has selected Populous, which was also the committee's recommendation. We received some strong proposals, and ultimately it came down to experience, and specifically experience designing MLS stadiums. Mm-hmm. And so that is why Populous was selected. The intent to award has gone out. Once the board approves it, then we'll have 10 days, and then we can begin contract negotiations. So that's where we are now. If there are any specific questions about the process, but we are asking that the board approve the intent to award this morning.
And I noticed that John Cooper is with us today. I'm not sure if John, since he's joining us, our law director, has anything to add or wants to touch on this process, but we'd welcome you to join us.
Sure. Thank you for having me. I was prepared to kind of give a summary of where everything stands related to the stadium and where we are in negotiations. Do you want me to come back and do that later, or do you want me to do that as part of this?
Let's do that now.
Okay. I was not involved in the procurement process for the architect. That was handled through purchasing. But I can tell you about everything else that's going on.
I think it's helpful just to see the whole big picture and
sure. As
it relates to this piece.
So I will try and be brief. If you want me to move along, please tell me. I will. I'll give you a little bit of the history just because it has been a few months. You'll remember back in October 2017, this board and the Fair Board approved resolutions requesting the council to conditionally authorize the issuance of up to $225 million in revenue bonds by the Sports Authority for the construction of the new MLS stadium. The next month, the council approved that resolution. And as part of that resolution, there are a number of conditions that have to be satisfied before this board can authorize the issuance of any debt. So I'll go through those again because they're very important conditions. First is an execution of a development agreement between the Sports Authority and the team, which we're working on, and I'll explain more about that in a minute. Execution of a ground lease between the Sports Authority and the Fair Board for the site where the stadium will be built. The execution of a lease subject to approval of MLS between the Sports Authority and the team. That would be an operating lease agreement. The execution of a guarantee agreement with personal guarantees required in the event John Ingram is no longer the majority owner of the team. A council ordinance approving a ticket tax is a condition that has to happen first, and that would be $1.75 per ticket for years 1 through 5, $2.25 in year 6 and 7, and going up to $2.50 year 7 after. And a portion of that ticket tax would be set aside for capital expenses on the stadium, which is something that we haven't had in other agreements. So I think that would be very helpful for this board going forward. There will also be required an ordinance approving the demolition of the existing fairground structures where the stadium will be built. Now, by charter, that will take 27 votes of the Metro Council. So that's the kind of the biggest hurdle from a council standpoint is getting the 27 votes on that ordinance. After the council approves it, the fair board would also have to approve the demolition of the structures. Not part of the debt issuance, but contemplated as part of the deal is the private development ground lease for a portion of the property. The Sports Authority would not be involved in that. That's the fair board, and that is the public process that was described that is currently underway. So we begin drafts of the agreements, the development agreement, the lease, and the guarantee, the team lease, and the guarantee back in February. If you remember in the past, the board and Metro have used Larry Thrailkill for negotiating similar deals. Mr. Thrailkill is now retired, and I'm not sure, I don't even know if he lives in the state anymore, but he was not available. So we retained Craig Hammond and Trevor Whiffen with Dickinson Wright Law Firm. Craig Hammond is out of Detroit, and Trevor Whiffen is in Toronto. And they have done a number of professional sports deals, financing, stadium construction deals, and have been very helpful as we've gone through the process. We're still negotiating the final version of the documents, but we are very close. The team has been very good to work with, and I think things have moved along very smoothly, given how things could have gone. So I'll give you a quick summary of the development agreement. This would be between the Sports Authority and Stadium Co., which is the subsidiary of, Ingram that will be over this project and operating it. The Sports Authority will be responsible for the construction of the stadium. However, the agreement contemplates a cooperative mutual endeavor between the Sports Authority and the team's rep, which will be Icon Venue Group. And so there's a lot of good faith language in the agreement about working together, since they're obviously the primary tenant and user of the facility and need to be involved as we move through the construction process. There will be a development committee that will be made up of two Sports Authority reps and two Stadium co-reps, and they will work together throughout the design, development, and construction phases of the project. Commencement of construction is to take place by June 30th, 2019. The demolition of all the existing facilities would have to take place before that date. It will have to be delivered in, I think, what's called a site pad ready condition for construction. The final plans will need to be approved by MLS once we get the final design done. The stadium will be between 25,000 and 34,000 seats. The Sports Authority, in consultation with Stadium Co., will direct the activities of the construction manager as we move through the process. The stadium is set to be ready for occupancy by February 1st, 2021. So I think that's the target date for being move-in ready. If you will remember from the resolution that you approved back in October, Stadium Co., the team, will cover $25 million, a portion of $25 million of the design, development, and construction costs, and will be responsible for any cost overruns associated with the stadium. So anything that goes above that amount issued, you know, the debt issued, and their $25 million contribution will be the team's responsibility. We've also been negotiating the team lease agreement, which is an operating lease agreement similar to what you have with the Predators and the Titans and the Sounds. The team will pay rent in the amount of the bond debt expense per year. So whatever the debt requirements are that year, that is what will be paid. Now the team will have a rent reduction from that amount which will be the total amount of the sales taxes and ticket taxes collected at the facility. So they'll essentially get a credit, lease credit, or rent reduction, however you want to think about it. For years 1 through 5 of the stadium operation, Metro is guaranteeing that those tax revenues will not be less than $4 million. So if there's a shortage between actual collections and $4 million, Metro would make up the difference out of Metro revenues. And then for the next 5 years, that would drop to $3 million a year guarantee. And then after that, there is no guarantee. The payments will be made in installments coinciding with the bond payment dates, so that, you know, the money will be transferred from them in time to pay the debt requirements. The team will be responsible for all operating and maintenance expenses of the stadium. Metro will be responsible for capital expenses. And like I said, a portion of the ticket tax will be set aside to cover capital expenses. The team will be required every other year to prepare a capital asset management plan to be submitted to the authority that will list what those capital requirements are, and there's language built into the agreement that will provide for kind of an outside party to work with the team to prepare that. The team will be responsible for all utilities. They will be required to maintain operation here in Nashville. They will be entitled to all revenues associated with the stadium, which is concessions, naming rights, advertising, and parking for stadium events. That would not include parking for fairgrounds events, just for stadium events. The team will be required in the agreement to coordinate scheduling with the executive director of the fair board to make sure that the fairgrounds events and the soccer events coincide, and there's plenty of advance notice built in for that. Metro will be entitled to 20 rent-free days for Metro events. That's the very broad what that could be used for. But that is 20 days that we will have rent-free. Metro would be responsible for covering the operating expenses associated with those events, obviously, but it is rent-free. And then the agreements will include the standard insurance and indemnification and our regular boilerplate stuff. One thing that is that I had not seen before that's been put in the agreement is some MLS requirements that have to be in the lease, namely making them a third-party beneficiary and giving them the right to step in the event of a default. These are things that MLS requires to be in lease agreements. The plan is for all of these to be ready for board consideration and approval in June or July, and we're actively working to get the documents fully negotiated, and once we do, we will get them to you, so you will have plenty of opportunity for review. I'll be happy to take any questions.
I got a question. John, what's the action that has to be taken by the council, and when's that scheduled?
Nothing is scheduled yet. It will be around the same time, I think, but the council will have to approve the demolition of the existing fairgrounds facilities. We're anticipating all of this being done at one time, so it would be separate legislation, but all in one package. So an ordinance approving the demolition, an ordinance approving the ticket tax, then there would be an ordinance approving the a lease agreement between the fair board and a private developer for the private development portion. So that's the council action. They don't have to take any further action regarding the debt issuance. That's left to the sports authority. But those are required things that the council will have to address.
Okay.
just wondering about the definition of capital expenditures that Metro is obligated to pay. Is that in conjunction, like normal definitions,
yes,
like the IRS?
Yes.
Nothing different than
nothing,
that?
Nothing
okay.
different.
I have questions. I understand it. There's the anticipated annual debt on the bonds. It's about approximately $13 million. Is that right?
I do not know.
Okay. The question I have is about the guarantees, the form of the guarantees, because as I understand it, I may be wrong, but I'm under the impression that $9 million of the annual debt service
right.
is guaranteed
whatever
by
the difference is, right.
is guaranteed by Stadium Co. and John Ingram is the principal owner of Stadium Co. What form is the guarantee going to take?
The guarantee agreement that is incorporated into the operating lease right now is a team guarantee. Okay. So the team will be guaranteeing that everything. I mean, it's a pretty strong guarantee, but there is no personal guarantee unless John Ingram is no longer the majority owner. That was a condition of the council and the council resolution. So the language in the agreement is consistent with the amended language that the council put in the resolution.
So if he is no longer a owner or principal of Stadium Co., then what happens?
Then the owners would have to provide personal guarantees, and those would be have to be acceptable to the director of finance and the director of law. I think there's some other language surrounding that, but we don't have the personal guarantees drafted yet because they're not necessary. But when they do become necessary, the agreement provides for how that's done.
Is there any discussion about the amount of the guarantee if he no longer is a?
It would be for the
full amount.
Yes.
A personal guarantee.
Right.
Okay.
Are there any additional questions for Mr. Cooper?
Thank you. I just want to say that was really helpful. Thank you so much for going through all of
Thank
that.
Thank you, John.
Sure. Thank
very,
you. Thanks for having
very
me.
Helpful.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
So I think that brings us back to our part on the agenda as it relates to this consideration of a resolution for the intent to award letter that we did receive this morning for the architect and design. And Monica, talking with you, you've been very close to this process. It's gone through the proper channels and
we have gone through the process and it's a multi-step process, and we're still working through the process. But the next piece is to get board approval on the intent to award, which as I said before, would allow us to enter into contract negotiations in 10 days from now. And then then a contract will come back to the authority for approval.
Thank you. So at this time, I think there is a motion to approve the resolution for intent to award for Populous. We would entertain that at this time.
Move approval.
A motion. Is there a
second?
Motion and properly seconded. All in favor?
Wait, some discussion.
Additional discussion?
Yes. My understanding is, because we just got this morning, is that we are just a step in this process of awarding a letter with the acknowledgement that there will be an award to this particular company. And this company, this firm, this Amy firm, had 6 MLS projects. Is that right?
That's correct.
We haven't really heard a lot about who this firm is. And so, I think we've been given a rating sheet too. Submitted
good.
To the
okay.
mayor, so we've just okay. seen that. But we will see this contract
That's all right.
at a later date. So this is just a step to move this forward so the public will have notice of this contract and everything.
And so that we can enter into contract negotiations and work through.
Right, so this is just the next step in that process. Just want to make sure I have that correct.
This may not be answerable today or by people in here, but, so, and this is really, the RFQ, I haven't seen anything like this before, so this is really helpful. It's nice to be able to look through the scores and how all that took place. I see as a weakness, they've listed community engagement, failed to demonstrate an understanding of the fairgrounds and neighborhood impact. And I think we see how important and vital that is. So when people are awarded a contract, do they get to talk about these types of things and say, we're so excited to work with you, but you better improve this, this, and this? We saw these as weaknesses.
Yeah, and that's the point of the negotiation. So that gives us an opportunity to sit down and really set the expectations and to move forward to make sure we're all on the same page. Absolutely.
Well, this has been nice to read through, even though we just started reading it.
Yes, it is.
It is. It's hot off the press. Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor to approve the resolution, say aye.
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 Any opposed? Ayes have it, motion carries. And at this time, we will go to our Finance Committee Chair, Lisa Howe, for her Finance Committee report.
So we had a Finance Committee meeting before this meeting, and appreciate all the board members being there, those that were in attendance. And we did not have to approve anything today in our meeting. We had a great presentation by Janine Kaufman and the Titans. We first talked about seat use fee at Nissan Stadium and their auditors from Ernst & Young, which I was glad to see Ernst & Young in the room. They're a great inclusive employer and they worked locally with the Nashville office. And basically, they audited the seat use fee that we get, the ticket tax, and what Janine gives us every month. And the Titans don't have to do that. They just do that out of good faith and have that audited, and there were no discrepancies. And so that was great to see. And then the other big part of our meeting was Janine brought forth some capital projects updates, things that they want to be working on from June 2018 to March 2019. We were able to look at a list of capital projects. Most of them were on the facility assessment. A few were not. Most of them, or almost half of them, they had gotten estimated cost for us. And that came to $1.1 million. And there were still some without estimates, so that's probably gonna be well more than $1.1 million. The board is not required to approve anything. It was just a very transparent, very proactive list of items for us to look at. And I thought the Finance Committee and those of us that were there vetted through some of those and asked all our questions. And maybe there are people who weren't there that looked at the list and have any questions for the Titans. So we don't need to approve anything, and I think that concludes my report.
Thank you, Lisa, for that report. Are there any questions? Okay, moving along. We also this morning met and had a personnel committee prior to this meeting at 10:15. The personnel committee is made up of the officers of this body. In addition, several other board members participated. Monica, and the purpose of that meeting was to discuss request. Monica, along with nine other Nashville leaders, has been selected to attend the Young American Leaders Program at Harvard University from June 11th through the 14th. 12 cities across the country have been invited to participate. The program is on U.S. competitiveness and studies, innovation, and collaboration as a way of achieving shared prosperity. The personnel committee voted this morning and recommended approval to for the authority to set the selection process and endorses the benefits and training for the authority in the city. The total cost out of pocket for expenses is estimated to be about $850, and the department budget can absorb this expense. There are no other questions at this time. We will consider the personnel committee recommendation for approval. Any discussion?
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the expense, and all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Congratulations, Monica.
Thank you.
We are proud of your selection and know you will represent us all well, so look forward to hearing back on that trip. Next up, we are to facility questions. This is the part in our agenda where we talk about our other facility partners. If there are any questions for, I think today we're gonna dive into Bridgetown Arena and the Predators, but if there are any additional questions or comments as it relates to the operations and activities at Nissan Stadium or First Tennessee Ballpark, this is the time when we would discuss that. And I would like to just note that I had a great time out at the ballpark on Sunday and was pleased to finally get to see an MLS or the Nashville FC, I should say, team play there. And it was really neat to see how the team at the ballpark is working to really accommodate the soccer fans. And it was a fantastic experience, so if you haven't gone yet, I hope you're able to go check out a game, and also baseball. Baseball is playing strong, and so certainly encourage everyone to participate if they haven't yet. I believe also this time, if there's anything, I don't know if there's any other comments on First Tennessee Park, but Mr. Underwood is here with us to just touch base on a letter that was submitted a couple of months ago to for just a discussion item and to put on the board's radar consideration of planning for Major League Soccer and how that will impact using Nissan Stadium in the future. So, Mr. Underwood, thank you for joining us.
This past November, our organization, our stadium company, approached by principals of the new Major League Soccer franchise in Nashville to see if they could play their inaugural season in our building, which we would be thrilled to accommodate. We are already receiving some requests for other events in 2020, and we'll have our busiest year in the history of the building this year, and next year we'll have a new record number of events in our building. We believe the same thing will be true for 2020, exclusive of the Major League Soccer events. Major League Soccer plays currently a 34-game schedule. That means there would be 17 home games in our building, assuming that we could accommodate them all. In my letter to Commissioner Garber, I made clear that there would be some scheduling conflicts that we would have to work through. One of those, of course, would be the CMA Music Festival, which occupies our building for nearly 3 weeks in their load-in and move-out and event runs. So that would be a little bit of a hurdle for us to get over. As you know, CMA Music Festival is considered to be, is treated as if it were a civic event under the terms of the lease. In our judgment, it does not qualify to be a civic event, but we treat it that way as part of our compromise with the metropolitan government from 17 or 18 years ago. We are perfectly willing to work with Major League Soccer and want to do so in good faith, but if we host 17 of their home games and 10 of our own home games, we will be very near the limit of exclusive dates under the lease, which is 30. We will have more than 30 events in the building in 2020 should we host the Major League Soccer games. And I don't think it's necessary for anything to happen today other than for us to reemphasize what's in my letter to Monica of December 26th of last year and my letter to Commissioner Garber of around Thanksgiving of last year, where we made the commitment as part of their final push to obtain their franchise. But we would like to get it up on your radar because it is something that is going to become a challenge under the lease as we begin scheduling events for 2020. So if there are no other questions, that's really all I wanted to accomplish this morning, was to emphasize the importance of this to us, the restriction that is contained in the stadium lease, and just sort of make you aware of what we need to be thinking about as we move forward. What my letter suggests is a waiver for the Major League Soccer dates. I'm not sure we would need a waiver for every one of their home games, but certainly we would need to make sure that even in the absence of a waiver, that there was not going to be some conflict created under the scheduling provisions of the lease, because the Metropolitan Government does have rights which we fully recognize under the stadium lease and the related agreements.
Can you explain? I'm still a little bit confused. What is the exactly the 30 reserve date limitation? It's defined here. It's a defined term in your letter. If you could just explain.
You know, the many things I know almost nothing about, public bonded indebtedness would be near the top of that list. But my recollection from the negotiations was that the limitation was put in place as part of the public-private use doctrine that relates to the issuance of public debt for private use. Margaret could probably help us with some of that if she were willing to do so, Margaret Darby. But I don't think that it would necessarily create an issue with the bonds or the validity of the bonds, but I'm guessing that's the general vicinity of where that limitation arose from. And of course, it was also built, the stadium is a multi-use facility. We will host, I mentioned this at one of the more recent meetings, we will host another 300 gatherings this year in our stadium, in our two magnificent club areas and in other discrete areas of the stadium, to say nothing of the 20 or so very large events that we will host in the bowl of the stadium. So there's a lot going on there, but the exclusive date provision was created in connection with events that are going to be in the bowl that would interfere with the other uses that could be made of the stadium on that day. In other words, it's exclusive to our event on that day, as opposed to the other things that could be going on in parking lots or in clubs or in the other discrete areas. So it's sort of a shutout, if you want to look at it that way, of other events on the 30 exclusive, the maximum 30 exclusive dates per year.
So if I understand what you're saying, the Titans have up to 30 days reserved for them and their uses, and what you're saying is that you just want clarification that the 17 dates that are going to be used for the soccer stadium don't count against that 30. Is that correct?
Yes, or put another way, we don't want our willingness to assist a friendly competitor to keep us from hosting other events in the building.
Okay.
I would rather just get it out there. That's really what the inquiry is about. We don't want to, by attempting to be generous with the Major League Soccer franchise, to disable our ability to host other large events, which we will most surely have. At the same time, we don't want to put Metro or the bonds at risk or whatever the rationale was for the 30-day limitation. It's a one-time ask. We're not going to run into this problem, we don't think, in any other year. But it is something that is important to us because our events business is critical to our success as a stadium company.
Thank you, Steve.
I just wanted to say, I remember when the announcement of MLS team was made, how much the commissioner of MLS emphasized how the Titans, Preds, everybody in this town really was so receptive to having the team. So I just personally want to thank you for
That's very kind of you to say that.
You know, helping make that happen.
Well,
I just think it's important to always emphasize how that cooperation really makes things like the MLS.
You know, a lot of people did a lot of things to help us get here. And we regard having a Major League Soccer franchise as a positive, not a negative. It's something that will be good for all of Nashville. Having another large facility will be good for Nashville. You see the interaction of all of the sports in what we hope will be a favorable announcement next week about us hosting what we think will be Nashville's largest event ever, the 2019 NFL Draft, where we would expect several hundred thousand people to be here over the weekend. And if Major League Soccer's facility was available, that would be another venue that could be put on the radar. And it's true not just for the NFL and the draft, but for scores of other events that come to Nashville. It's an entertainment and destination mecca here, and everything that we can do to help foster that, I think, works for everyone's benefit. But thank you for saying so. If there are no other questions about my presentation, I would like to take the opportunity to thank all of you again for your selfless dedication and commitment to public service as members of the Sports Authority. Thank you for our owners and for our organization.
Thank you, Steve. I think it's a nice conversation that we're having, talking about all the events out at Nissan Stadium, and thank you for bringing that item to our attention today. And I know we will, we're all anticipating having MLS here and accommodating them at the stadium as well. So thank you very much. And I think that brings us on to our Bridgestone Arena report. Sean Henry is here with us today, and we'll start off the presentation.
I wish I wasn't here.
Well,
hola, good morning. Yeah. Right now we should be in Las Vegas celebrating last night's win.
Yep.
And ready for tomorrow's game. You know, Laura feels the same way with the nasty email she sent me after we lost last Thursday. But really, I was asked just to kick off today, talk about this past year. We're about 6 weeks away from the end of the fiscal year. And upon great reflection, after still being a little bit sore about not still playing, we get a chance to really celebrate a great year on all fronts. But before I do that, there are a lot of people to thank, you know, for creating where we are today and what we've accomplished over the past 20 years, more so over the past 10 years from the point that this team almost moved. There are two individuals that really contribute to our success as much as almost anyone else, and unfortunately both passed away this week. One is former commissioner of the SEC, Mike Slive, who, if you haven't read yet, you know, passed away just recently. And when you look at what he did for our organization, for our city, his commitment to the Music City Bowl, his commitment to us and his building. When I first met Mike in Nashville, I met him in Tampa before that, he asked us to bid on an SEC tournament coming up. And we said, well, we don't want to bid on one. We want to bid on 30 of them or 40 of them. And he laughed, like Mike would if you don't know him. Very gracious man. And we said, well, no, we're serious. We're going to bid on multiple. He said, well, no, you're going to bid on multiple years. You'll get one. And over the course of 3 or 4 days, he kind of bought into the confidence that we had, that you guys gave us, the presence of the Sports Authority, the Sports Council, the cooperation from Metro. And he did something that he didn't plan on doing. This is what made him so special. He changed his plans all the time, and he gave us 12 straight SEC championships. That commitment he made to us gave our organization so much credibility to move forward. So if you didn't know him, he really was a great man, did a lot for us, did a lot for me personally, but most importantly, did a lot for this board and the city. So just want to thank him. And then a little closer to home, if you didn't know a gentleman named Gerald Glover, he was almost a day one season ticket or employee for us. He's been here about 16 years. You may not know his name, but I promise you, if you're ever in our building, you know his laugh, you know his personality. He was larger than life, physically and emotionally. He passed away on Monday in a car accident. Again, been here about 16 years. Contagious personality. On his back, we literally built events. I mean, he ran our conversion crew, just a really incredible guy. So I want to say thank you to both of them, because it's hard to celebrate this year without recognizing two people in very different ways contribute to where we are. So if anything represents how we feel about this season better than this awful book we gave you today, it's this awful book we gave you today. Because the idea was, we're going to give you this book, I was going to be in Vegas, and Kells was going to tell me how it went. This was for you to keep your journal throughout the Western Conference Finals and ideally the Stanley Cup and the parade and beyond. But today, it's nothing more than a reminder that these things arrived Friday morning. So Friday morning, we all had a hangover, literally, figuratively, about the season that really was a wonderful year. And I realized, you know, Janine was so kind a moment ago to tell me what a great year it was. And my wife was the same way, my boss, and all of us to each other. It was a great year. And thank goodness I have my mom, because she reminded me how awful it was, because we're not still playing. Because she kept me humble. But it was a great year, and the further away we get from the sting of that loss, we're going to recognize it. But I do want to quote Mike's live a little bit and pull out my brag bag, because there are a lot of things to talk about and celebrate. And before I do, I really just want to say thank you. I talk about this a lot. When I got here 8 years ago, we did not have a very good relationship with this board, put it mildly. Everything we earned in that relationship, and over the past 6, 7, 8 years, you all worked so hard to give us credibility, to allow us to move forward and become the franchise that we are today. And I don't know if anything is a better reflection of that than this card, my shorthand, that is full of a lot of accomplishments this year. But every one of these accomplishments, you guys are a part of. There's no doubt about it. I don't want to go into all the business successes that we've had, sold out over 100 straight games, wait list is exploding with those that want to buy season tickets or individual games. Those are all wonderful things, but there are some really other nice awards that we got. You know, the first one, for the first time ever, won the President's Trophy, which there is no curse with the President's Trophy. So before anyone else brings it up, I realize the past six winners got eliminated from the playoffs. I hope we win it every year that I'm here moving forward, because having a great regular season puts you in a position to have a great playoff season, but you do play the game for a reason. You never know how it's going to end. But we won our first ever President's Trophy. We won our first ever Western Conference regular season championship. We won our first ever division championship. And those things are all absolutely tremendous. We were named ESPN's number one sports franchise. We were named Arena of the Year by so many outlets that I get confused with the acronyms, but from IEBA to CMA to talent buyers to promoter tours, I mean, I just go on and on. There's about 17 outlets that named us Arena of the Year, which I think has made us Arena of the Year for about 12 years straight by one of these, where it's the first time ever by everyone that grants that award, we won that award. So it's pretty rewarding when you think about our ultimate goal and our mission statement is to be the number one sports franchise, or the number one venue in North America built around a Stanley Cup championship. And we accomplished half of that a few times. Someone said to me, why do you set that as your goal? You're going to fail almost every year. I said, yeah, probably. But by having that as our goal, even if we fall short, we're going to achieve something much greater than most thought we could at that point. So we're proud of those things. A lot of executives were honored this year. David Kells was Executive of the Year by Polestar and IEBA, and I think by CMA, too.
Sure.
I say yes. It was a rough day for him. David Poile won Executive of the Year in the NHL. David Poile also now holds the all-time wins record for GMs in our 100-year history of the NHL, which is an incredible thing when you think about all the great people that have been in that position that many years, and David now sits atop everybody. The award that I'm most proud of, more so than anything else that we won, short of the ultimate thing that we hope to win someday, is the Workplace of the Year Award. That's something we take great pride in. I think we've been nominated 12 times and won it 10 of those 12 times. And that's always a special thing, because that shows what we are as an organization, and it also shows why we can accomplish some of these things that we have out there. Spirit of the Chamber Award, PK Subban, Rebecca. I always say award, but it's King now, right? For about 6 years. But Rebecca King won Metro PD's Spirit Award as well for developing the Blue Line Buddies program that PK stands behind. And basically, it's bringing police officers and families from certain areas that might not have the best relationship with police officers, bring them out, meet the team, have dinner, watch a game, meet the team again, and build lasting bonds. And it's something that the rest of our league and a few other teams around sports are copying right now. We're pretty proud of that as well. That's something that PK's personally visited with the commissioners of three of our four major sports leagues right now, and ideally you'll see that copied by 120, 122 teams across all sports. And then we have a few more awards to come, we hope, you know, knock on what could be wood. You heard about our award that, again, I was going to bring it up. I thought it was a secret. I didn't realize it was so public. But we're proud of that award as well. I mean, it's not just that Mike Fisher is being honored, but the team is as well. And, you know, Mike was such a great captain for us and a great leader, but he's also a great person. And And I think the legacy he leaves behind our team isn't just some of the lessons he taught the guys on how to prolong your career, how to be great on the ice, it's how to be great in the community. And that's what Mike stands for. And then, of course, the team, we're very proud of that as well. But Pecorine, who is without argument the best goalie in the NHL, and I think that really showed in our loss and some of the comments that he made of how personal he thought he was responsible where we were in a negative fashion, and never once ever took credit for where we were in a positive fashion. It's who he is. He's nominated for the Vezina Award. P.K. Subban's nominated for two awards. One is the Norris as the best defenseman, and the other is the King Clancy Award as the best person, if you will. It's almost the Man of the Year Award at the NHL. We'll go to Vegas in June for awards, as opposed to Vegas right now, to play them. And ideally, we win something in Vegas this year if we can't win the games that are there. So when you look at it, it really has been just a great year. I mean, it really has been. And I know I'm going to get yelled at later by Michelle for being the Eeyore still, which is an odd thing for me. I'm normally fairly energetic and positive. But there is a sting with losing. When you set your expectations to win the Stanley Cup and have a great regular season, to compete at the highest levels and put yourself in the position to own home ice advantage without the playoffs, that's the goal. Anything short of that is we have to look at it and say, okay, what we do wrong? And sometimes you don't do anything wrong. We played the second best team in the league at the time, regular season team, and with a coin flip, they could have been the best team, we could have been second place, our second best team. It was a great series, played seven games, really wish we didn't. When you look at our team, there's really nothing you would change for a different outcome. I think if we played those guys 100 times, we'd win 50 and they'd win 50. The problem is our league makes us play that odd game, so someone has to win. And it was their turn this time. And, you know, they're playing great hockey. We're not ashamed of losing. We're just disappointed in where we sit. But what we're really proud of, talk about David Poile and all his success, it comes from the way he approaches the long-term viability of our franchise. And the way he's layered our contracts for the next 3, 4, 5, 6, 8 years, we have an opportunity to be one of the elite teams in our league for years to come. So that ultimate goal that we have, we're going to achieve it. There's no doubt about it. I just hope we do our job and win Arena of the Year the same year we win that trophy, so I can check that off the list. But it was a great year. Sincerely, I just want to say thank you to all of you for creating the environment that allows us to do some of the things that we do, because they're not always traditional, and we're proud of that. We like being a non-traditional team. We do things that other people at first laugh at, then they look at quizzically, then they ask what you're doing and why, then they ask how you're doing it, and then they copy it. And Canada being the hotbed of hockey, so they claim. That was funny. Last year, Winnipeg came here to understand what we did during the Stanley Cup. There's no greater compliment for a Southern hockey team than a Canadian team coming and saying, what did you do? How'd you get 100,000 people to hang out with you before a game when it was 98 degrees out? And we showed them exactly what we did, who we worked with, Public Works, police, fire, the city, ourselves, the sports council, the CBC, and they were scratching their heads and said, that's just too many initials, it's too many people. Our city just keeps saying no every time we do something outside. So Danny Schaffner, who runs our marketing department, spent a lot of time on the phone with their mayor's office, with their Public Works, to say, this is what you should do and this is why you should do it. Their biggest thing to get over was, why are we copying Nashville? And they didn't even have ice until they did it. And they celebrated us when we were up there. Unfortunately, the wrong way, they beat us. But from a city standpoint, the mayor went out of his way to come to us and say thank you for showing us how to celebrate this great game outside. So of all the great accomplishments we have, I think convincing the Canadians that we do hockey better was one of the best ones of all. Now I say that, I don't know if any live in Nashville watching that TV, they're going to get all offended again. But we celebrate hockey a certain way. We know we have the best fans in sports. We know we have the best fans in hockey. And it's just fun to see Vegas celebrating in a similar manner, and then Winnipeg as well. Eventually, Montreal will too, and then we achieve something. So, again, I just want to say thank you for putting us in a position to do all those great things. And if you have questions about the team or the building, I can answer some of those. But I think you have David Kells, Kyle, Rebecca come up as well. Do you have any questions about why we lost? Or reflect on a really great season. So, thank you.
Hi there, I'm David Kells with Bridgestone Arena and the Nashville Predators. Thanks for having me this morning. In addition to the awards that Sean mentioned, just yesterday, Venues Now, which is an industry trade magazine, announced its nominees for the 2018 Women of Influence Award, and our own Ashley Stokely has made that list. So we're very excited to see that. That conference is in June, so we'll see the results of those elections coming up soon. Running over some of our events in the near term and in the future, our last round of events was May 4th through 10th. It included 5 sold-out events over 7 days with over 76,000 people through the doors of Bridgestone Arena in a 7-day period. It was Foo Fighters, Five Finger Death Punch, Justin Timberlake, and the 2 playoff games during that run. So it was an amazing run for us. We were all exhausted at the end of it, but it was totally a great experience. Over the past several weeks, we've had on sales for Fleetwood Mac, Pink, Marvel Universal Live, Childish Gambino, and J. Cole. This week we're going up on sale with Drake and Shawn Mendes. For Shawn Mendes, please get out your long-term calendar. That show will be August 2nd of 2019. We're looking forward to once again hosting the CMT Awards.
No, we're not.
We have a backup plan with the CMT Awards. If we're not in the playoffs, they come into the arena. But since we are not in the playoffs, we are hosting the CMT Awards. We're looking forward to a lot of first-time headliners for Bridgestone Arena. Music icons U2 and Paul Simon will be their first appearance here. And we're also happy when new performers rise up to the arena level. That means more content and long-term performers are coming our way. So we have Chris Young, Harry Styles, Kesha, and Sam Smith all kind of in that vein. We're always looking to bring new content and provide entertainment for all of Middle Tennessee. So in the last several months, we reached out to Latino and Hispanic promoters. So we were working with CMN Events, and we were having our first Latino headline event with Bad Bunny in September. In total, we have 40 events on sale now with 274,000 tickets already sold to those events, going all the way out through August of 2019. Anybody have questions on the calendar and events coming up? Thanks for your time, and up next is Kyle Clayton for a financial review.
Kyle Clayton, Bridgestone Arena. One thing Kels failed to mention, with those shows that are already on sale for going forward, we roughly have about $30 million in ticket sales committed to those 240,000 tickets. Last year, this time, it was about half that is what it was on sale. So this really goes to show you, you know, as our hockey team and everything progresses, concerts progress. So it's one of those that both entities feed off each other, and it really is a, you know, a perfect storm, if you will, that we're in right now. Talking about our financials for the year so far through March, we're about 160,000 people ahead of last year as far as attendance goes between the hockey and concerts. As far as revenue goes, as you see in your packet, I briefly mentioned that we're about 27% ahead of where we were last year just on revenue alone. It's about $2.8 million. And the key drivers there are really rent revenue for events, rent revenue for hockey, which is based off of ticket sales, food and beverage revenue, which is really just all the bodies that are coming into the building. Obviously, we're increasing our per caps as we get new bodies in the building as well. As we're attacking our debt service, our CU charge revenue is up about 60% from where we were last year, which is fantastic. And then our box office revenue, as we're selling all these tickets, obviously our ticket fees are increasing. So as revenues are increasing, obviously our expenses will probably go up a little bit. As revenues are up 27%, our expenses are only up about 8%. So it's a great balance there, the way we're operating. The few expenses that are up are obviously our staffing. As we're doing these events, we're having more bodies in the building. Our staffing expenses are higher, along with some maintenance and repair. As we're getting the building older, we're reinvesting in some of our processes and mechanicals. So therefore, that's up a little bit, about 14%. But overall, expenses are only up 8%. As the year goes right now, our bottom line, we're actually up about $1.5 million compared to where we were last year, which is a great place as we've got 3 months to go towards the end of our fiscal year. So we're really in an amazing place financially. To give you a quick update on our SIF bank account right now. Through the end of March, we have remitted $2.1 million to the city as part of our collections. At this point last year, we only remitted about $1.3 million. So we're well ahead of where we were last year at this point, and actually at the end of last year, 12 months, we remitted just over $2 million. So we've already surpassed what we remitted in all of last year. We still have 3 months to go. So we're in a really good place there. The loan balance at the moment is $6.7 million. We have a capacity of about $3.4 million that we could borrow right now.
And so you can see that everything's just trending in a great place right now with the balance on that. That's really all I have. If you have any specific questions for the financials, go ahead, Margaret.
Any update on renegotiating our ability to borrow money given those revenues that you just reported?
We have continued conversations with Metro Finance and Bob Black. He actually talked to him a little bit yesterday. We're continuing that process, but we don't have anything new to report just yet. If nothing else, I will turn it over to Danny Butler, who will give us a Fort Ice update. Thank you.
Thank you.
Danny Butler, Fort Ice Center General Manager. Thanks for having me today. I'll be pretty brief since we met at Fort Ice Center just a few months ago. I wanted to recap a few events that we've had over the last few months. We hosted a girls hockey weekend at the end of February, early March. We hosted it at all three ice rinks basically in the city. So at Fort Ice Center, at Centennial, and also there's a small rink in Franklin called the Lab. We had over 150 girls come out and try hockey for free over that weekend. They got jerseys, they got to play, and we had two Olympians who came out to practice that weekend. So it was really exciting, and it's really kind of sprung forward what we're going to be doing this summer, which is starting a girls only learn play program. So really excited about that, and really excited about starting our girls program and growing that here in Nashville. On top of that, we had the U.S. Figure Skating annual meeting just a couple weeks ago. The praises that U.S. Figure Skating gave Scott Hamilton Skating Academy were more than they've given anybody almost ever at that event. They're really high on everything that we are doing out at Fort Ice Center here in Nashville. We have the highest percentage growth of U.S. Figure Skating registrants in over the past year, which is incredible to see, just you know, a two-seat facility. They also asked our skating director, Paula Trujillo, to sit on their planning and growth committee, which is exciting to have somebody from Nashville on that. Hockey's absolutely exploded. We have 35% more kids playing hockey this year than we did last year, which was 30% growth over the year before. So it's been incredible. The GOAL program, which is a free hockey program for kids 4 to 8 years old, has been sold out all last season. We're already sold out through January right now, which is great having those kids come out and play. And then one thing I touched on last time we met was a program that we're just starting called Scott's All-Stars. It's a program for youth who have intellectual disabilities. We received a grant from U.S. Figure Skating to start this program. And right after we met last time, we launched it for the first time. We're currently in our second session. Basically, the program is a six-week learn skate program, but it goes above and beyond learn skate. There's some hockey skills, there's off-ice yoga, strength and conditioning. It's really well-rounded, and we include the parents in everything we're doing. So it's been a great program. We've already had 35 kids go through the program. We're in our second session. The Preds are paying for 10 kids to go through the program over the summer for our figure skating camp. So it's really been a great program. U.S. Figure Skating is really high on it, and it's really gotten a lot of notice across the country. I just want to touch on a few events coming up. Every week this summer is booked with either a camp or a tournament, which is exciting. Our first summer open, I think we have one camp. This year we have every week except 4th of July booked, which is great. A couple of those highlights are the Gretzky Hockey School, which we had last year, which Wayne showed up. Which we expect them to come this year. The Elite Edge Hockey Camp, which hosts hockey prospects to D1 coaches or junior coaches. And then, of course, the Preds are hosting their Preds Hockey School for 2 weeks of this year. Curling completely took off during the Olympics, so we decided to keep it, and we have a curling league that's starting this summer, and that starts the end of June. So if you guys want to get a team together, I think there's still a couple spaces together. We are working on the NAIA National Hockey Championship, hosting that at Fort Ice Center. It's coming up here. NAIA hosted a varsity national championship up until 1984. 1984, they decided to stop the program. Last year was the first year they brought it back. 8 teams last year. They have 12 teams this year and 16 teams the following year. So really exciting opportunity to host the national championship at Fort Ice Center at Antioch. And we're currently working through that. And really exciting, we're going to host a free hockey camp and a free figure skating camp this summer. And really that is to get people to see what we do from around the country and in Middle Tennessee. We want to give people the opportunity to see what Paula does so well on the ice and what Zach does on the hockey side. To really taste what we're doing and see why what we're doing is so successful. So we're really excited about that. And like I said, we're booked all this summer. We're basically booked all of next season already, so we're already booking into 2020. So things are really good at Fort Ice Center. We're really excited about it. Any questions?
So, of course, it was really amazing when the women's hockey team won the gold medal against the Canadians this year.
Absolutely.
So were the Olympians who came, were they from the women's
hockey? They were. The two gold medals, I don't remember their name. It was the twin sisters, or the two sisters on the team. So
that was on, yeah, that
yeah,
were on
they
the
came
team.
On, yeah, we had some pictures. We did a meet and greet at Fordyce Center with them. So
that's very exciting.
Awesome.
That's wonderful.
It really is a program that needs to grow, and there's one girls hockey team in Nashville now, and that program truly, we see the need for that to grow, and with these 150 kids coming out specifically for girls only, we're excited.
Well, it's wonderful that you could bring the Olympians in. That's
it was
wonderful.
Fun. Next, we have the heart and soul of our team. Really, Rebecca's going to speak now.
So Kim promised not to make you cry today with videos and stories, but a lot of what we do can be conveyed in video and pictures a lot better than how I can speak. But I stand between lunch and you leaving here, so I've abbreviated a little bit of what I'm gonna say, and then we have a short video at the very end. We did provide a sheet of paper that includes all of our financial commitments that we've had this year. This success of the team on the ice really leads to greater success off the ice with the foundation. We get increased requests for money, increased requests for donations, but because we're able to raise so much more money, we're able to fulfill so many more requests. We'll distribute over $1.2 million in cash to the community and well over $2 million through in-kind donations. Our grants increased by $100,000 from $500,000 last year to $600,000 this year. We gave over $240,000 to our local children's hospital, Monroe Carroll Jr. Children's Hospital. And I anticipate in September that we'll increase that by $100,000. We do the check presentation every September with PECA. The fund was started with Shea Weber, so a lot of our player legacies live on even when a player leaves our team. So we anticipate about $340,000 going to Children's Hospital for pediatric cancer research. Some of the high-level stuff that you may not see from videos or news articles is the attachment that our players have for the causes in the community. We had Roman Yossi renting a limo and bringing buddies to the gala. We had Pekka and Roman attending the prom, which happens the night before games. It's not an appearance that I set up or asked them to do. They're emotionally impacted and have a huge passion for Best Buddies through their time and then also through donating money. Roman raised over $35,000 directly for Best Buddies, which will help open more chapters in elementary and middle schools in the Middle Tennessee community. Our fashion show this year, we really went out on a limb. We did a Nash Vegas casino night for many, many years. Our players wanted to do something different, so we decided to create an event that we knew nothing about.
We found Dillard's at the Mall of Green Hills. They were fully on board to help us change up this event. We had no idea if we were going to even raise half the money that we would for a similar Nash Vegas, but we wanted to present something a little different for our fans. Our players jumped on board, their wives got involved, and then we also brought in youth from local youth organizations, and the kids actually stole the show. They walked the runway with the players and just brought light to our event. And this event ended up raising more than our biggest Nash Vegas that we held the year prior. Blue Line Buddies, Sean briefly touched on it, and we'll have a little clip on it. In October, PK came to us and he says, I want to do this program that unites police and youth. And he said, I want to do it every single game. And I said, oh, can we do it once a month? He said, no, every single game. And he said, I want to meet them before the game and after the game. And I said, oh, what about just after? And he's like, no, I want to meet before the game and after the game. Done. Every single game, 41 games, we had 41 youth, 41 police officers meet before the game and meet after the game. And the transformation that happened from that initial meeting at 4:15 to the end of the game at about 10:15 was dramatic. This letter I received in the mail today, and I made a copy of it, and then I included the photograph. I'm not gonna read it to you because I think you can do that on your own, but the one line that I will have, it says, PK, you are single-handedly changing lives in the community. Thank you so much for your vision and leadership. Creating positive interaction between our youth and officers is such an important initiative, and it's already making a difference. We will continue our relationship with Sergeant Brown going forward. So literally on a piece of paper by the child and by the big brother, and it arrived yesterday, which is why I just passed it out to you. Kyle Torres was new to our team, and we had him through his choice as the face of our Hockey is for Everyone initiative. It's a league-wide initiative that happens in February. Through his leadership, we were able to invite 7 organizations to come to a Preds game. Oasis Center Just Us program, a girls hockey team, Sled Preds, amputee organization, and also Special Olympics. And they got to meet Kyle after the game. They got to attend the game. And then Sled Preds also got to skate on the ice and stand with the starting lineup. I actually have a meeting with Kyle next week, and he and his wife want to figure out how can they get more involved in the Nashville community. If you Google him later and see what he did in Ottawa, he is a huge addition to our team, both on and off the ice. We're looking to maybe add blind hockey to Nashville. That's something that we don't have. We'll work with Tennessee School for the Blind. We'll work with Danny Butler and see if that's a new league that we can grow the sport of hockey, but using a new outlet with blind hockey. Next year, I promise I'll be even shorter if you do one thing for me. If you take out your phones and follow at Preds Foundation. We're on Instagram, we're on Twitter, we're on Facebook. If you just friend us, like us, follow us, all of these stories, all of our players are documented on those social app platforms, and would love for you just to follow them and kind of keep tabs on what we do. But through Sean's leadership, our office mentality is one goal. Our staff volunteer over 8,000 hours a year, and that's with our busy schedules, our busy events, the life and blood of our team, our staff, and our players, and we're very passionate about giving back. Now that we're out of the playoffs, you'll see our staff wearing their Preds gold very proudly, volunteering all summer long. So if you follow Preds Foundation, you'll see all the organizations that we are impacting. We have just a short video that's kind of taken some clips and highlights more of the things that we do.
Welcome to the 2018 National Predators Grant Foundation allocation ceremony.
Today we invited 149 different charities from the Middle Tennessee area to accept over $607,000. It's our largest one-time allocation in team history. We spend the entire season raising this money. It comes from our beer festival, our wine tasting, our golf tournament, and all of our game night silent auctions. And in one day, we distribute it in one swoop.
Well, the amazing support that the Predators Foundation does to be able to give back to our community is just incredible. And the ability to be able to have these funds to support the missions of so many organizations trying to do good to help those that are vulnerable and fragile is just, it's extraordinary beyond words.
The impact of their gift to BEP, Business Education Partnership Foundation, we have a STEMX camp for science, technology, engineering, and math careers to introduce middle school students to all the different opportunities that are out there through some hands-on experiential learning. And because the Preds are supporting us in this endeavor, we're able to offer this experience for kids tuition-free so that any student who wants to participate and learn about careers can do so regardless of their family's financial circumstances. It's a huge celebration for us to have this many people in one room. They are doing great things for our community, and we're so appreciative that we can raise money to help what their efforts are. The people that came today are the ones in the trenches doing all the hard work, making big changes for our community. So we are happy to support all of their different initiatives.
So that pretty much wraps us up today. Sean mentioned, you know, it really was a tremendous year. We do have one last short video, because again, we want to celebrate this year, but we're really turning the page, looking forward. We're excited about all the things coming forward. So any last chance for questions, we'll just play the video, and then we have some refreshments if you guys can stay. So, thank you very much.
Okay.
Predators organization. Your team is just incredible, and of course you wanted to make us cry yet again with two videos this time, not just one. But I would also like to make a note. I saw she snuck out, but Michelle Kennedy, there was a really nice feature on her this week in Style Blueprint as being a face of Nashville, and hopefully we can circulate that to the board. It's just, again, shows from the top down what type of organization you guys have, and it's really tremendous to be a part of it. So congratulations to her on that nice feature. This has been a great meeting, as usual. I appreciate everyone's time today. Our next meeting will be June 21st, and if the board would keep their binders here, we'll recycle those for use for next month. And thank you all for attending. Seeing no other business, I would move to adjourn. Okay, we are adjourned. Thank you, guys.
Oh, yeah.